Steve Alcorn's a fine investigator.
Oh, fuck off.
This is the Fortean Slip with your host, Chris York.
I don't need porn, Chris. I have a good woman.
Listen, I have a good woman. I still watch porn.
Co-host, Steve Alcorn.
You are the top shit in Bigfootery if you get the invitation.
Oh, are you?
I've gotten the invitation 2 years in a row now, Chris.
Wow, not me.
And sometimes special guest, Matt Knapp.
It's part of growing older, you know? Maturing. Uh-huh. Be more dignified and stuff.
Okay, George Washington.
I opted for the...
Is that what meth addicts say? It make me more dignified.
Taking on all things strange since 2013.
Wait a minute.
I don't know what the hell.
Are you saying that he's pregnant?
Possibly.
Was he implanted by one of these teenage aliens?
Didn't it happen to Arnold?
This device, which comes as part of Nintendo's Quality of Life initiative, is
going to have kids running around banging their heads off bricks.
Yeah.
You're about to witness the strength of creep knowledge.
Hello, and welcome to the Fortean Slip. This is episode 95,
that's
yeah.
A good title.
Yeah, episode. It's been a couple of weeks. We were off last week. Matt was a bit under the weather, I do believe. You feeling better?
Feeling fantastic.
See? He's fucking jovial. He's upbeat. Guy doesn't even drink fucking coffee. Steve and I swill it down like it's fucking life force.
I don't even fucking drink water. I mean, well, to me, coffee is just...
out the gate.
I put some fucking water in the coffee.
Right. It's just flavored. It's flavored water.
I hope you don't chew it like fucking tobacco.
I like coffee-flavored water.
I was just like, every time I make a cup of coffee, I'm like paranoid about fucking floaties. Even though I know like the fucking whatever winds up in my coffee is probably not going to kill me. And I won't notice it if I drink it. But I just sit there and fucking have to fuck with the spoon on the top of the water. Breaking the surface tension just enough to get that fucker in there.
See, if I drank coffee, I'd be worried about floaties in an entirely different way. It doesn't sit well with my stomach.
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck about what's in my coffee. I'd drink it anyway.
As long as it tastes like a real man.
LSD, like DMT.
As long as it tastes like coffee.
That's how he sees shit fucking jump across the room, man.
Oh, speaking of which.
Oh, boy.
Yes. If you check out my Facebook timeline, my sister posted something on there this week. There's a pair of red, white, and blue Chuck Taylor All-Stars, which I had a ghost experience a long time ago, and that's what I saw run across the kitchen. And they were the exact same shoes. Check it out. Go to my Facebook timeline.
You had a ghost experience involving a pair of Chuck Taylors running across the room?
Yeah, but here's the thing, Matt. They didn't make those at that time. This is like the 80s, late 80s.
Yeah, I kind of thought you were talking about a phantom pair of shoes.
It was a phantom pair of shoes, yes.
But specifically Converse.
And specifically the American flag. It was red, white, and blue, but it was a specific style. Well, anyway, they sell them now. Exactly.
So phantom shoes from the future.
Yes. Phantom shoes from the future. Chuck Taylor's.
He is a time traveler.
Your family ever check for any sort of like...
He's a fucking time traveler.
Natural gas leak under your house or anything like that?
It's possible. I don't know what's going on there, but there's some weird things that went on in that house back in the day.
Yeah. I think weird is a fucking understatement.
How can you can't make that shit up, you know?
No, you can.
let me rephrase that. I can't make that shit up. I don't have that kind of imagination. But the story in my family, the story is well known, and I'm the only one who saw it, of course. Of course.
Just a pair of shoes.
Just a pair of shoes, yes. They ran right in front. We had a big chest freezer, and they ran right in front of that. And that's how I seen the shoes.
The ghost of Rex Kwando was running through the house.
But anyway, if you check out my timeline, the actual shoes were there. She was looking for a new pair of shoes for her son and came across those, and she was going to buy them for him. But, you know, just to freak me out, really. And she didn't buy them.
She's just going to throw them through the room one day.
Well, she's going to have him wear them at my mom's house for, like, Christmas or something. And I would go out in the kitchen, and he would be walking across the floor with one.
She went out and got some wire and fucking marionette set up.
So it would freak you out if you saw a relative wearing them.
Well, if nobody told me, because here's the thing. I've always considered that perhaps a glimpse of the future, you know, because they didn't make a window, those. If you will. Right. Or maybe it's
a window, if you will, into shoe fashion.
Well, the thing is, they didn't make them at the time. And
I think this could be like the first case of a sighting of disembodied shoes.
I think that fucking Tommy Hilfiger or somebody's got to get in touch with fucking Steve. Isn't Hilfiger dead?
I believe I've told this story on the show before. It's not the first time I've told it.
Maybe he could give like some fashionistas some like ideas for shoes for the future.
Yeah. So what's the big craze next fall, Steve?
Did you see? Have you seen a pair of fucking self-lacing Nikes? Like,
no, but Nike claims they're working on them.
In 1982, I saw a pair of shoes that inflated.
Well, it was probably closer to 87 or 88, but yes.
And then I saw a kid get beat to shit and have him ripped off his feet.
Yeah.
No, I'm just saying, I've always considered it perhaps, you know, something that would eventually happen because they didn't make those shoes back then. And obviously, they didn't make them prior to that, so it couldn't have been a dead person.
In the cosmos, this most improbable chance, like all of the factors and energy and things that we don't understand that would have to take place happened. So you could see a pair of fucking $30 Converse.
There's $60, but yes.
He's Cisco right. From The Flash, Matt.
Well, you know, stranger things have happened.
Yes. Yes, they have.
Can That's we change his name to Vibe?
I've had glimpses of the future before. Chris and I talked about this on a show at one time. You know, we see things and then somehow they happen. But that one was weird because it was so fucking random.
I still haven't seen those fucking lottery numbers.
No, I haven't seen those yet either.
God damn it. That's the fucking future vision I'm hoping for.
Yeah, but see, this was so random. It didn't tell me when the shoes were going to walk across the floor. In fact, I still haven't seen them walk across the floor. But, well, actually, a friend of my brother's had a similar pair.
I thought you said you saw them walk across the floor in front of the chest freezer.
Well, the ghost shoes I saw walk across the floor, yes. The actual pair of shoes with somebody's legs in them, I haven't. Feet in them. So I've always been waiting. Now, I have a friend of my brother's came over, and he had some red, white, and blue Chuck Taylors on, but they weren't the same style. They were red, white, and blue, but they weren't in the same configuration. So I knew that. No. But when my sister sent this link to me, I was like, holy fuck, those are the shoes. So, and they're a new style, so they just came out. So
that's now, deep.
Yeah.
You saw a glitch in the Matrix, Steve.
I saw something, but, and I know I get a lot of guff for it, even from my own family, because nobody else saw it. But
no.
Why would anybody give you a hard time for that shit?
Well, because it's so outrageous.
Is it?
Well, it is, because who sees fucking tennis shoes walk across the floor?
Specifically those tennis shoes.
Yeah, specific tennis. I mean, not just
any tennis shoes.
I mean, if it was like some like groundbreaking tennis shoe that had never existed or something, that might make it a little... Well, it's just a particular pattern, Steve. The shoes had been out since, like, the 50s.
Right. But that pattern didn't exist, as far as I know. Now, if I'm wrong,
I don't think it's a very popular pattern either.
No. Well, it may be now, but it wasn't then, if it existed at all. And I've done some research, and I can't find anything older than maybe 10 years or so.
I don't think people are clamoring for the American flag print Converse, actually.
I don't know. They're pretty cool. They're pretty cool looking. I'd wear them.
Yeah. You and Bruce Springsteen.
Yep. And my nephew, because that's who my sister
is. And your nephew, exactly.
That's a riveting. I mean, that's a riveting story, Steve.
Fucking nuts?
It's riveting. No, it's riveting.
People
want to know, Steve. Tell us more.
Well, that's all.
We want to know vibe.
I mean, I saw disembodied.
Tell us about the jean jacket you saw in the bathroom.
Yes. When you touched it, what happened?
I don't know.
Tell us about the gentleman that when you had your wide stance, you accidentally bumped his foot.
You guys don't believe me.
The friendship bracelet on Highway 64, that lonely night.
I know, it sounds like I'm totally making this shit up, but
no, it doesn't.
I opened the roll top desk drawer and found the skeleton key.
Like, if somebody was going to make up a story about a ghostly encounter they had, this would not be it.
Right. And so I think that lends credibility to my story.
Absolutely.
Oh, sure. Yeah,
and, you know, I'm an honest fella. So, man, I've had a lot of those kind of, I mean, a fucking frog jumped off my TV. You know, I've had a lot of weird, crazy experiences like that.
Yeah. Well, I think we've all had weird and crazy experiences. Just yours seem to be cartoonish.
Well,
if I were to describe your paranormal experiences, it's like watching a fucking episode of Looney Tunes.
Yeah, Looney Tunes paranormal.
And you got the frog singing in the background. And he always sings,
"Hello, my honey. Hello, my darling."
What was his name? I forgot.
I don't know.
That was one of my favorites, though.
That great frog. But yeah, so we've been off for, what was it, 2 weeks? We didn't do a show, though, right after Halloween. Things have been fucked up. For those of you who are fans of the show, for the record right now, a couple of things. First of all, Facebook bent me over and fucked me in the asshole. So, if anybody could grab some links off the blog or shows and share them around, that'd be great. Because, you know, Facebook likes to tell you can't do something and not tell you what the stipulations are so that you don't do it again. And then they just do it to you again. So...
Fucking Facebook.
Mark Zuckerberg literally shows up at your house with just a huge spike strap on.
Yes.
What kind of sneakers?
Fucks you in the asshole.
He's barefoot, Steve.
Oh.
But well, yeah.
I believe you there.
So I'm not... I am able to post things. It's just very... For a week or so, it's going to be rather light. Because... I want things to work well.
Even slip light.
Yeah. And on another note, I guess, well, actually, I know for a fact, but we'll say allegedly because the post is now gone.
Allegedly.
I had screenshotted my analytics because... a certain podcast host who will remain nameless, who's bearded, tells a lot of bullshit, decided to say that he was going to report me for harassment. For what? I don't exactly know. I haven't messaged the guy. I don't run around posting a ton of shit. I was just responding to a comment that the dumb fuck had made where he said that we only get 300 views per show. Which...
How many views do we get, Chris?
Per show?
On average.
Yeah. 302, Steve.
Yes.
yeah.
We win.
301 and a half. That's what we get.
I'm going to have to tell my mom to start watching the whole show.
Yeah, that will help. But no, we get, on average, I think now if you take, like, all shows of all time, average it all out, it's over 1,000 per show. Now, is that fucking 1,000 fucking solid viewers? You know, and that's an average number. We have some that are well over 20,000, some that are over 10,000. I have videos that are over one video that's over 30,000. But because Mr. Big Boy, you know, has his, you know, he obviously has a bigger channel than we do. Although you can't see because he hides how many subscribers he has. But he has a bigger channel than we do, or I do, because it's my channel. And he obviously gets better views on a lot of stuff than we do. Has to run around and tell everybody that he's the reason that this show is as big as it is.
Even though we, according to him, we only get 300 viewers.
And that I don't post anything original. I don't do anything original. All right, for the record, this show is completely fucking original. Besides the fact that we grab news stories and we talk about movies and shit like that, this show is completely fucking original. The stuff that I do when I record my stories, with the exception of a few where the wording of the stories is so small that you can't really deviate much from what's there, I rewrite everything that I fucking do. But, you know, I don't do anything original. You know, the commentary that we made when we did the news, all original. For someone to say that this show and the stuff that I put out is not original, because I share other people's stuff to my blog, is horseshit.
Which is a common practice among
I blogs. Fucking Love Science is one of the biggest blogs in the world. And all that blog does is share other people's shit.
Right. Well, that's what, you know, this type of blog, that's what I do. That's what I'm doing on my blog. It's what, Bigfoot Evidence does. It's what,
Easy, always. Steve.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. Everything on that blog. It's
however, what we're talking original. About, right. What we're talking about though is, you know, the story that you're referring to came from somebody else, you know, like a YouTube video or a news story or whatever. So it's not like, as long as you're writing at least most of the copy,
it's what everybody does, including the person bitching about it.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. No.
He runs around and fucking tries to act like everybody else is shit, and what he does is amazing. It's amazing. I'm so glad every time I listen to his fucking show, I got to hear him click the fucking goddamn button on the mouse and then listen to 5 to 10 seconds of silence before I heard somebody's fucking voice. That's fucking professional.
Listen, whatever Jeff does, excuse me, the bearded wonder does.
Oh, wait, that's
you might have to edit that out. The bearded one. Hey, to each his own. You know, I have no problem with him.
Jeff who?
Doing his, yeah, the Johnson, the Bigfoot campfire stories, whatever, you know, anything he does, whatever. Do it, man. Just don't bitch about what we do. And
yeah, and stop referring to other people sharing your shit as sucking your cock. Why is it every time you get into a fight with somebody, you have to bring it to fucking gay man-on-man blowing each other?
Maybe he's closet and just doesn't want to admit it. You know, usually that's what happens.
And if you could get Renfield to stop running around and bitching for you, that would be fucking great.
Who's Renfield?
Some tattoo artist from fucking California who fucking has his nose stuffed so firmly up somebody's asshole it isn't funny.
Huh. Not familiar with the guy.
Nah. You shouldn't be.
I don't care. I mean, listen, I stayed out of the whatever stuff that was going on this week because really, it's just childish anymore. You know?
I was sick and came back to like 28 days later and shit.
You woke up like fucking Rick Grimes.
Yeah, and I just ran with the fucking zombies. Fuck it.
I'm just tired of the lies. I'm tired of the fucking lies.
It's a bunch of drama and it's a bunch of shit talking and everything, but like, if you got a problem with somebody, you know, take it up with that person. Don't act like you're attacked whenever they're responding to shit you fucking said. And then you want to sit back and act like you're attacked. Don't take credit for other people's hard fucking work. Because I call shit like it is. And Chris, you definitely have your fucking personality faults. Everybody does. But Chris works harder promoting his shit than anybody I fucking know. Like, so much to the point that, like he was saying, Facebook fucking tries to block him from doing it. I mean, the guy is constantly working on promoting his blog, his show, posting articles, doing everything he can, more so than anybody fucking else. And I know because I've been doing it for a long fucking time. And to sit there and try to take credit because you fucking promoted the show or something, that's just a kick in the fucking balls that's uncalled for.
Listen, like, we know he's, you know, mentioned us on his shows. We kind of worked together for a while, you know, but what did that really get us? And I'm not saying anything against his show. He's got a successful fucking show.
Yeah, I've stated that.
That way, you know. Leave it. Hey, I got a successful show. You got a successful show. We can all be happy. We're not competing, you know. His show is specifically
the same markets.
No, his show is specifically one topic, and we go over every fucking topic. It's not the same thing. So why? And maybe, you know, I get it that he was pissed that you post that, whatever. But so what? Just drop it, you know. Don't go and start, you know, bringing up people's sexual orientation and all that bullshit just because you're pissed off. Not that your sexual orientation is anything.
What are you saying, Steve?
It's still in question, Steve.
But somebody can't fight with facts. They go to you just like to suck my cock and all that bullshit all the time.
But you're sitting there making the claims, and I'm not saying these claims aren't necessarily true for the specific genre that he's in. You've got the biggest show. You've got the biggest audience. You've got the biggest numbers. Then be the bigger man. Right. Quit talking shit about other people's shows. Because, you know, you and him got into it on a personal disagreement. It happened a long time ago. Me and Steve are part of this show. Talking shit about this show is talking shit about us too.
And I had previously worked it out with the bearded gentleman. Not worked it out, but you know, we came to an understanding. And so I'm sure that tomorrow I'll get a, you know, nasty instant message on Facebook. But you know, whatever, just do your own thing, man. And that's all I care about. Just
don't act like you're fucking the hot shit that fucking made everybody else what they are. You're not.
I mean, he's...
Don't act like you can throat punch anybody who fucking stands against you. You'd fall the fuck over.
I'm just saying, he's got... No, I don't listen to the show anymore because, you know, I just... It's the same thing, same old to me. But he's got a huge following as far as people in the Bigfoot community. And I would dare to say, besides maybe that stupid hoax show all the time, that's what is it, Sasquatch Chronicles or something, besides maybe something like that, he's probably got the biggest following and the most listeners, and so he's successful at what he does whether you like him or not, you know. So just leave it at that. That's all I'm, you know, that's my point. So whatever. You know, you don't need to fuck with our little piddly show. Just be, you know, and it goes back to that whole, you know, we threw him under the bus thing. Of course, for the record,
I didn't fucking throw anybody under the bus.
No, but that's how
initially, I fucking apologized to the guy. I have the messages. I fucking said, I'm sorry. I can't fucking do this anymore. My show is based on calling out bullshit. And the show that you just put out was a bag of fucking horse shit. And I'm sorry, but I cannot stand behind that anymore. I apologized to him countless times. And he just fucking lit into me. Because I'm a disrespectful, disloyal motherfucker. Fuck you.
Lately, anybody associated with us is now feeling the same heat, which is kind of wrong. I mean, associated.
Yeah, if you got something to say, say it to me. Don't block me on fucking Facebook. Don't fucking hide behind your bullshit and fucking talk to other people and message other people. Like you were saying, Steve, he'll message you tomorrow, but he won't fucking say shit to me.
Maybe Jeff. Well, excuse me. The bearded gentleman thinks, you know, that I'm a sheep, and he's pretty much said that to me.
No, he did
thinks
say
I'd
that.
Do whatever the fuck you say. Yeah, he thinks I do whatever the fuck you say. I'm here to tell you that this is not true. You know.
Yeah, you guys are just my fucking puppets. I've got my hand firmly up both of your assholes.
I think that was the same.
I do some pretty good voices, but I don't think I could do both of yours.
But listen, we're independent thinkers, and my issues with him were different than your issues with him. If you go back and listen to that show we did. You were arguing one side, the bullshit hoaxing, or not hoaxing, but the bullshit show that he did. And I was arguing the hypocrite side, you know, so it wasn't the same. I had just,
I wasn't arguing any side.
I don't think you were on the show, were you?
And still, here I am.
In the middle.
On the fucking show that you're talking shit about. Thanks.
Because, you know, I, you know, regularly just fucking, you know, talk about them.
Right.
You know, I've brought it up twice on the fucking show in 2 years. And for the record, the issues that I had were longstanding. I had been fucking mulling shit over for a long time about it. I'm sorry, people. I cannot sit back and support things that I think are bullshit. I'm not gonna. It's not the person that I am. If I'm gonna stand behind something, I want it to be what it claims to fucking be. You know,
and leave our fucking British guy alone.
Yes.
Shit, well, you got one fan and you wanna fucking steal him and fucking beat him down?
Well, you tried to hijack him, but that is whatever, you know.
Speaking of which, this horrible fucking segue as we jump out of this fucking shit. But I wanted to get that out because I'm sick and tired of people fucking lying. It just, to me, if all you can do is run around and lie about other people's success, then what the fuck is that?
Is it a lie if you truly believe what you're saying, though?
Yeah, it's still a lie. I mean, it's kind of like if a tree falls in the woods, doesn't, and nobody's around, doesn't make a sound. Yeah, it still fucking makes a sound.
In other words, when he claims that he made our show and all that bullshit, he really believes that, you know? So, I don't know. I'm certain he really believes that.
Yeah. I just wanted it to make the point that, hey, I get more than 300 views per show. That's right. All my fucking point was, and that motherfucker had to make it about fucking him building my show. Eat me. So, speaking of the schizophrenic Brit, I guess he took some heat for his ferret, I don't know what we do, rant, is that what we're going to call it? I know it's the ranting of a schizophrenic Brit, but are we going to call it a rant on ferrets? I don't know. But anyway, being paranormal. So this week's Richard Allen, Sir Richard Allen, for your enjoyment.
So my last rant fell under certain criticisms as ferrets weren't considered 14 by several fans who messaged me to complain. Thank you, gentlemen. Your comments were taken on board. So, to appease the fans, I shall now rant about something undeniably Fortean. hamsters. No, seriously, I'm not talking about hamsters. What I will discuss, however, is the unbelievably stupid cryptid, the pointlessly idiotic idea of Bigfoot in the UK. No, I'm not fucking joking. I wish I fucking was. Apparently, there are people stupid enough to buy this, that England and Scotland have the abundant resources and habitat necessary to support a great ape. Possibly the dumbest thing I've ever heard since Ed Waterman said he had a picture of a Bigfoot giving a reach around to a werewolf. Okay, well, maybe not that insane. But still, how could an island that is completely explored, conquered and reconquered and then bombed to fuck support an animal the size of Bigfoot? How could an ecosystem so fragile that the introduction of the American mink nearly annihilated two species claim to have a large ape sitting at the top? Well, it obviously couldn't. When I was told about this, I genuinely thought it was a fucking joke. Then, of course, I naturally blame those woo cunts that insert themselves everywhere. There are woos even in England, yes. But there are also flesh and blood believers. It's insanity. North America is vast. While it has mostly been explored, there are still places that people just don't go, and a vast array of different ecosystems. England is small and well explored, and I don't think there is anywhere anymore that people don't go. A couple of big forests, but I think that's a stretch to say that a Bigfoot could be living there. Do you know what an actual argument I got into one of these fucking idiots was? Well, England can support parakeets and terrapins, so why not Bigfoot for exotic animals? Well, firstly, yes, terrapins can survive here, but the weather is so cold that their eggshells don't get hard, so they can't breed. And parakeets, yes, they survive down south around London, but that's a fucking city, and it's a fucking bird. A tiny little bird and a small reptile are more than a fucking stone's throw from a goddamn one-ton ape, yeah? What would it fucking eat? Oh, nuts and berries, of course, man. Well, that's epically brilliant. Now tell me exactly what nuts and berries throughout the year. Oh, well, mushrooms as well, of course. Another epic idea. So, according to these fucktards' logic, a population of Bigfoot with a deep enough gene pool to support longevity can sustain itself purely on nuts, berries, and mushrooms. Well, man, when you say it like that, it sounds kind of stupid. Well, duh. Oh, well, what about deer? Aha, got you there. Not really, you cretin, as all of our deer herds are way overpopulated because we killed off all the natural predators. So if giant apes were eating them, I think we'd fucking know. Ah, so then, man, they must be paranormal. Oh, go fuck yourself. I think the Romans might have mentioned Bigfoot when they conquered us, or the Normans, or even the fucking Anglo-Saxons. But no, no mention of Bigfoot from them. Gosh, it makes me fucking sick to my stomach when you think of all the hard-working Bigfoot researchers in America. Well, some of them. Well, a couple of them. Well, one of them, maybe, who struggle to get taken seriously when we've got all these fucking dumbass cunts in my own country talking total shite. It's a fucking circus act, is what it is. Insane. Ah, speaking of insanity, you know Edward Waterman, total fucking yogurt. Take that with a pinch of salt and lime and a straight shot of tequila.
Did you go Mexican?
I guess so.
Wow.
Like... an international festival that time.
So for the record,
I don't always rant about Bigfoot in the UK, but when I do,
for the record, I want to state to our first of all, who the fuck complains about a ferret? You know, a ferret rant. I mean, come on, he was having a little fun. But if Richard Allen wants to come on our show, Sir Richard Allen wants to come on our show and talk about wiping his ass, then I think that's okay. He can talk about whatever the fuck he wants.
Absolutely. So, absolutely. You
know, fireside chats with Steve Alcorn.
I'm just saying, you know,
Richard, I thought about doing
romance. Draw the line there, actually.
I recently thought about this, Matt, and I don't know, like, I don't know how into it you would. Well, no, I wouldn't involve you. But I was thought about doing romantic internet meetups with Chris York. Like, talk about all the times I fucking met chicks. Because you and I have talked about those stories.
Yeah. Yeah. Got a few stories.
Oh, back to Richard Allen.
No, fuck Richard Allen for a minute. Fuck him. I want to note before we fucking get into the news that I called it on the fucking Coy Wolf.
You did?
Okay, you live under a fucking rock. All right.
No, because I seen your post about the Coy Wolf.
I've fucking seen more shit about the Coy Wolf in the past week than ever.
I do remember you mentioning the Coy Wolf on our last show.
My question is, why are people all of a sudden acting like it's a new thing?
Yeah, it's not. Populations have been increasing for a long time. They've taken over. They're calling it the apex predator now. I was fucking right.
Now, wasn't there a story several years ago about one running around in New York or something?
Yes, they're very fucking adaptable. Because they interbred with some of the larger dog breeds, as well as the coyote and wolf mix, they are not afraid of people. The intermixing of the dog breeds into the gene pool made them less likely to avoid people, which is also making it more dangerous because they will, on occasion, attack people. And you're talking about an animal. And you're talking about an animal that now, you know, before coyote attacks, fucking rarely ever heard of. But, you know, this is an animal now that can run in packs and take down large fucking deer. And even moose.
Yeah, they're big.
So, you know, but if any of you, like most of the people at this point in the show who are listening, have probably already heard the fucking show because it's all fans. But if you haven't listened to the show that I did with David on, you know, Life After People, The Rise of the Dog Man, which was, I mean, it was a total play on shit, but it's all about the Coy Wolf. And I just watched that documentary that PBS put out. And I can't remember if it had just come out or what the deal was. I had just found it on Netflix or something. And I watched through it, and I was fascinated by it. And it reminded me, like, of that story that I told you guys the last show about the, you know, the whole thing that went on with those, whatever they were, the dogs, coyotes out in the pit. But I just, when I saw that story trending, like, this whole past week, I was like, holy shit, I fucking called it. But, yeah, pat myself on the back.
Christopher York, caller of the Coy Wolf.
I'm fucking, and you know, I want to know, like, I've heard like a lot of people have like given Richard shit for hunting with ferrets. Okay, back to fuck you, Richard Allen. He's the fucking Beastmaster.
Yeah, he is.
He's the fucking Poto and Kodo, whatever the fuck their names were. He's fucking the Beastmaster. What's that guy's name? I can't think of his name right now. The actor.
Beastmaster.
Oh, Beastmaster. Yeah, we'll just call him Beastmaster. He fucked that fucking hot redheaded chick. That was great. That whole movie was great.
And then appeared in like two other things the rest of his life.
And then he was in Arrow. And that was it.
But he should have played Beastmaster in Arrow.
Oh, absolutely.
They should just go ahead and bring him back as Animal Man.
That's right. Fucking right. And give him two ferrets. Call him Richard Allen.
Give him two ferrets. Call him Richard Allen.
Oh, fuck this.
Are we not doing the news, Chris?
Oh, wait. Wow, what the fuck did I do?
You're ending the show early.
Holy news? Shit.
Oh, I got some good news tonight.
Oh, I'm sorry. That was bad.
I think you hit the... We'll just pretend. We'll just say that you hit the wrong button and then...
We're going to go to the land of make-believe?
Yes.
Okay, do you have any news?
I have news.
Okay.
That was the proper introduction.
Ah.
From the Washington Post, a reputable source for once. A rare illness makes people think they're dead. On November 5th, 2013.
She's dead. Butchered
it.
I'm going to butcher this name, but Esme Waijun Wang.
She was very badly raped, you see.
She came to the remarkable conclusion. See, I got the name right, but I can't sound out remarkable for some reason.
Oh.
She came to the remarkable conclusion that she was dead. In the prior weeks to this, she had begun to feel increasingly fractured, like being scatterbrained, but to such an extreme that she felt her sense of reality was fraying at the edges. She had started to lose her grip on who she was and on the world around her. Desperate to fend off what appeared to be early signs of psychosis, Wang went... Sorry.
He can't make it through Wang.
No.
Wang went... Sorry.
Hey, Steve.
Take three.
Steve.
Yes, sir.
You know who you know who they cast as Doctor Strange in Gotham?
No, who'd they cast?
B.D. Wong.
Yeah, Wong doesn't have the same appeal as Wang.
You heard it here first, people.
Yeah.
Wang went into a soul-searching...
What if it was B.D. Dong? Frenzy.
That would be much better.
Okay.
She read a self-help book that was supposed to help people discover their core beliefs and desires. She ordered and scribbled in five 2014 date book planners, reorganized her workspace, and found herself questioning her role as a writer. Then one morning, Wang woke her husband before sunrise. It's usually the other way around, isn't it? Wang wakes the wife, see? Wang woke her husband before sunrise with
sitting
an
incredible
sense of wonder.
Sitting it for a second.
Yes, I know. It sounded better in my head. They all do, you know. An incredible sense of wonder and tears of joy to tell him it all made sense to her now. She had actually died a month before, although at the time she had been told she merely fainted during a flight home from San Francisco or to San Francisco from London. She had drifted.
Doesn't living kind of negate the possibility?
Well, I don't know. I was convinced that I had died on that flight. I was in the afterlife and hadn't realized it until that moment, said Wang, now 32, who was convinced that her husband and her dog, Daphne, were also dead. I don't know. That was the beginning of when I was convinced that I was dead. But I wasn't upset about it.
Honey,
I thought that
do we have that life insurance policy?
She wasn't upset about it because she thought she could do things over and do them better. Her husband assured her that she and he were very much alive, an assertion she dismissed. But as the days passed, her bills turned into, turned into total despair. She lost all desire to work, talk, or eat because what's the point? You're already dead. Anyway, she suffered from this for 2 months. It's called Cotard's syndrome.
It's called retard syndrome.
No, it's Cotard's. Oh. Cotard's syndrome, in which patients think they are dead or somehow non-existent. Any attempts to point
it's
out the
Kotex
evidence to
syndrome,
conquer,
where they stick a tampon in and they think because they're bleeding, they're dead.
They are talking, walking, and using the bathroom, and they explain it away. French neurologist Jules Cotard first described the syndrome in the 1800s as a type of depression characterized by anxious melancholia and delusions about one's own body.
How do you walk around alive and think you're dead?
Yeah, I have to breathe, but it's all in my head.
And even in the article, it says you still take a shit. So, I mean, dead people don't have to shit, right? You wouldn't think.
Speaking of which, Steve, have you ever had a fucking the shits and it's like dry heaves?
Oh, yes.
And like
that is no fun.
It's like the phantom turtle.
Yeah.
Or Converse.
I'm sorry I even mentioned it.
I'm just saying.
Listen, I'm an open guy. I'm like an open book. So
you hear the splash and everything, and you get up and nothing's there.
He's like an open book, people. There's nothing written inside it.
No, I make it up as I go. But hey, it's there. Never mind. From the LA Times.
missile tests like the one the Navy performed off the coast of Southern California on Saturday night.
Proves the entire state are idiots.
Yes, present military officials with something of a conundrum.
It's a UFO, Steve!
On the one hand, said Lauren Thompson, a military analyst with the Lexington Institute, the military needs to give local aviation officials enough information as to the time and place of an upcoming test to ensure that no planes are in the area. But at the same time, the military is determined to keep the test shrouded in secrecy and in order to thwart any efforts by potential adversaries, namely Russia and China, to monitor the missile launch and flight, Thompson said. The confusion and social media uproar that erupted Saturday night as a mysterious white cone of light coursed across the night sky is an unfortunate but necessary trade-off, Thompson added. The need for secrecy was all the more important given the type of weapon the Navy launched Saturday from a submarine, according to Thompson. It's a Trident II D5 missile, and it's a centerpiece of the U.S. military's
ability to deter a UFO, a Steve. Nuclear attack. I saw a red circle around a thing in the sky.
Well, this goes all the way back, and it looked identical to me. The one that was in Norway, what was that, the early 2000s or whatever? You remember that, Matt, I'm sure.
The spiral.
The Norway spiral, yeah. And it looked like that. I mean, so, and that was determined to be a missile launch, a failed missile launch, but it was a missile launch. And people are still fucking calling these spirals fucking UFOs. I mean, and you can't get on the internet and look up Norway spiral without seeing that it's been debunked, you know?
Right.
Bunch of
fucking. Well, I was told that locally they even announced that it was a missile test.
Right.
And I guess since they didn't post it on Twitter or Facebook, nobody
heard that. Yeah. Nobody caught it.
Yeah.
You didn't get to vote on it on American Idol.
Right. There are problems with knowing in advance that and that's because the enemies to, or potential enemies to see the test, although it's all over fucking social media now. So I guess it doesn't matter. Right.
Since they launched it from a submarine, couldn't they have just, like, gone somewhere and done it without telling anybody and nobody's seen it?
Right, that's what they're saying in this article. I'm not going to read the rest of the article, but people obviously thought it was a UFO, but they did it near a fucking big city. Why would they, you know, you got this vast ocean, fire it the other direction, and nobody will ever see it. But they don't want, you know, like Russia and China and, I don't know, Tibet. I made that part up to see what they're doing because if they know the launch is happening, they have instruments that can track it and all that shit. So, and see what it's actually doing. So that's why they.
And I'd like to note for everyone listening and for Matt for his enjoyment that before the show, I of course go over the news stories with Steve, and I sent to Steve UFO over California, and his response to me was, "Do you have a link?"
Yeah, I didn't feel like looking it up. I looked up a bunch of them, and I found them. I just wanted the link that you wanted, Chris.
Oh, I was under the assumption that you just couldn't find one of a story everywhere.
It was everywhere. The LA Times, I think that's the one we just read. Washington Post, I think, had a story.
The fat bearded fuck.
I mean, so they were all over. They were all over. Yeah, he did a story on it. You know, he didn't steal the story. He just did a story. But so it was all over. But all I was asking was the link that you wanted me to use.
Oh, that's okay.
All. So, yeah. Being the investigative journalist that I am, I already knew what story you were referring to.
Oh.
From Idaho State Journal. Is it pronounced Pocatello? I think so. Pocatello?
Sure.
Yeah. Idaho? Yeah. Bigfoot captured. A documentary set to premiere on the History Channel on Monday has Idaho State University's prints all over it. My favorite guy, anthropology and anatomy professor Dr. Jeff Meldrum offers his insights on the program, which delves into the possibility of a Bigfoot existing and uses scientific evidence to back up that claim. But Meldrum isn't the only one from the university with their hands on the production of the History Channel special. The Idaho State University Robotics and Communication System Engineering Technology Program built an 8-foot-tall Bigfoot skeleton using a series of 3D printers.
That's awesome.
That would be cool, actually. To actually stand next to it was really, really quite amazing, Meldrum said. Even this was a bit of an academic exercise because obviously everything is just so inferential. Inferential? I guess
that's inferred, Steve. It's yes. All inferred.
Okay. But what it conveys is that, Meldrum is a professor, and he uses big words that I don't understand because I'm
not a professor of grammar or English or
no, but he still uses big words that I don't understand.
Or puppetry, obviously.
Yeah. But anyway, what it conveys is that otherwise difficult to imagine sensation or impression of standing next to a skeleton that's 8 feet tall. I mean, it's
huge. Which we'll be seeing shortly in Todd Standing's new documentary.
Because no actual Bigfoot skeletons have been unearthed, Meldrum had to reconstruct it based on what Bigfoot researchers believe the creature is related to. Meldrum borrowed from the physical looks of an extinct animal, such as the Gigantopithecus. Yeah, I butchered that. I know how to pronounce that, and I still butchered
it. Gigantopithecus bullshiticus.
Blackie, I think, is the...
Oh, Blackie, yeah.
Yeah. An ancient ape that was twice the size of apes today, and the Neanderthal, I think is how scientist people pronounce it, a species of human that is said to have become extinct 40,000 years ago. Meldrum took the Neanderthal skeleton, and technicians from the Idaho Virtualization Laboratory on ISU's campus, under Meldrum's guidance, and they digitally manipulated the skeleton to reflect the Bigfoot captured in the famous Patterson-Gimlin film. They made the shoulders much broader, the torso thicker, the arms longer, the legs the right proportion, Meldrum said. Then we took the Neanderthal skull away because it's more human-like. So in other words, they didn't reflect.
So why did they use the skeleton as the biggest model?
They said they used
everything about it and ditched the skull.
So anyway, that sounds like a fun show to watch, but I've heard people that have actually seen it, and they say it's a lot like that mermaid documentary. Yeah.
Well, right, but if they took time to read about it on the actual History Channel website, it tells you that.
Right, but I'm just saying a lot of people don't take the time to read about it on the History Channel.
That's why they tune into our show.
That's right. So we're telling them it's a bunch of bullshit, but it's probably...
It might be entertaining.
However, Sir Richard's favorite people, I believe, is in this show, and that would be Kelly Shaw. So that'd be something to watch.
Wow.
But anyway, that the History Channel would not allow media to publish a photo of the Bigfoot model before the documentary aired, so we don't get a preview of it. But I can't wait to see it, actually. I'm not going to actually watch the show when it comes out. I'll watch it some other time, but because, I don't want to. But I'd love to see the model. I think it would be pretty cool, a 3D model of Bigfoot.
Sure.
Do they cover it with hair?
I don't know. I haven't seen it.
Skills.
That is the news.
Great. Can I end
Kelly Shaw each week on Fargo?
Can I end the show now?
For real this time?
Sure.
Okay.
This has been episode 95 of the 40 and Slip, the Phantom Chuck Taylors episode. If you like this shit, hit the like button. If you don't, hit the little thumbs down button. Leave a comment. Subscribe. Tell us what you think. Share this shit around. Share it. Everything. Go to the blog. Share shit. Go to BigfootCrossroads.com. Go check out Steve's new blog. It might be up for a couple of weeks. What's it called, Steve?
TeamCrypto.com.
TeamCrypto.com. We hope that we can keep it up for longer than that, but we're not sure. Steve might lose interest in a couple minutes.
If the domain name doesn't resolve, it's TeamCrypto.blogspot.com.
And as always, check out Dreadfun at dreadfun.com and youtube.com/dreadfun. See ya!